I'm Jacoby Jacob, and I'm 64 years old, living in Rishon LeZion. My wife is Esti, and I'm working as an electrical engineer in the private company for consulting for some big projects that I manage now. I was born in India, in Ernakulam. It's near Cochin in Kerala. And when I don't remember anything from these old days, because when I was 1.5 years old, we came to Israel. As a matter of fact, all the Jewish community came to Israel in 1 or 2 years. It was in 53. 52, 54, all the Jewish group came to Israel. And we came to Shar Aliyah. This is the first point that all the Jewish came to Israel. It's near Haifa. And from there, my parents went to kibbutz Bet Hashita. It's in Emek Israel. And after 1 year, my brother, Avraham, was born in Kibbutz Bet Hashita. And then my grandmother came from India and they went to Nevatim. And my mother was so, she wanted so much to see her and to be beside of her. So we left the kibbutz and we went to Nevatim. But you know, after you get used to the kibbutz and going to Nevatim, it was very difficult for my parents. So after another 1 year, they left the village, left Nevatim, and came to kibbutz Ashdot Yaakov, Jordan Valley, near Tiberia. And there my two sisters were born, Avigail and Miki. And I think that we left the kibbutz after 10 years, in 62, almost 10 years, because my family in the kibbutz, we as a children, we enjoyed very much the kibbutz. It was wonderful for children. But my parents didn't get used to the way of living in the kibbutz. It's not because they were religious, but because someone was telling them all the time, you have to do this, you have to do this, and so on and so on. And after that, my father decided to leave the kibbutz and we came to Rishon LeZion. I learned in high school in Rishon LeZion, and then I joined the army. I joined the army when I was 18 years old, as all the Israelis, young people. And I went to the pilot course. I passed all the examination and so on, and I started it as in the pilot course. But I was not good enough to be a pilot, so I finished the course as a navigator. And in 1971, the end of 1971, and I went to a Phantom, the F-4 aircraft. I started to fly the Phantom in the end of 71 in base called Tel Nof. Yeah, I was, as a matter of fact, the first Cochini that got the wings of air crewmen in Israel. I have to tell you that I feel proud of it, of course, but not in those days. When I finished the course, I didn't think about that I am the first Cochini to be a pilot. But after a few years, it started to be in my mind, the back of my mind, that I'm the first one. I'm glad that during the year, some other finished the course, but only few. I'm sorry that, but it's only a few. I think that totally we are 4 or 5 pilots in the Air Force.
Cochini
pilots.
Even today,
yes, even today. I think it's starting with me, and until now it's only 4 or 5. And I'd be glad if more of them will go to this course. 2 years after I started my flights in Tel Nof, on Phantom, the Yom Kippur War was started. And I have to say that I was experienced, very experienced, because 2 years of flying on the Phantom, and I was very experienced. But even though, the war catch us by surprise. We are totally surprised by the war. And we started to fly like crazy during the days and the night to prevent and to attack in Syria and Egypt and so on. And you know that the situation in Israel was very, very difficult. The Egypt and Syria was inside Israel. They crossed the border. And before the war, we didn't think that this situation can happen. Impossible that they cross our border. We will cross their border. And I think that this reason was shock for many Israelis. The situation in the border was very difficult. And the government started to speak about the third house, that the third house will collapse. They were afraid of this point, that they will destroy Israel. The government was afraid that 2 temples of Israel were destroyed, and now it's going to happen again. And they decided to attack, instead a special attack in a very strategic attack.
הלחץ המתמשך של לחימה בשתי חזיתות מביא את הרמטכ"ל להכרה שיש להכריע את הסורים תחילה, וצהל יוצא לתקיפות עומק אסטרטגיות. לפידות הוביל את הכוח האווירי שהפציץ את מפקדות המטכ"ל וחיל האוויר בדמשק.
הייתה רוח מאוד חזקה מדרום לצפון. ואני, בשביל לשים את הכוונת על המטרה, הייתי צריך להילחם מאוד קשה במטוס בשביל שהוא לא יברח עם הרוח הצידה. אני מצליח בסוף לכוון על הצד הצפוני של המטרה. המטרה היא בצורת בניין, בצורת V, ואני מצליח לכוון על האזור הצפוני.
The capital is protected by mobile Russian-made missiles.
אני מעיף מבט, אני רואה, נכנס טוב בבניין. ועכשיו מתחילה התמודדות עם כל ההיבקים האלה מסביב. להימנע מהפגיעות שלנו מהם. בשלב מסוים אני שומע ש3 נפגע. הוא לא אומר שום דבר בקשר. מספר 5, עומרי, אומר לי שיש מצנח אחד.
So they decided to attack in the center of Syria, the headquarters of the Air Force, the Army Ministry, yeah. And they chose our squadron to do the attack. And I'll show you in pictures the way that we went there. And we are full of fuel and bombs. Almost 7 tons of fuel and bombs. We came from the north to Damascus, and we came very low level to prevent the missile to shoot us, and we climbed near the target. We climbed and through the bombs and planned to go to the north and through Lebanon to come back. They shoot me down after we saw the bombs, and on the way to low level again to escape from this area. It was very quickly that I recognized that the aircraft is, we lost the control on the aircraft and we have to eject. We ejected the aircraft, and unfortunately, the pilot didn't survive. He was killed because it was very low level. I ejected, the parachute opened immediately, and very quickly I came to the ground.
The parachute fell, and it took at least 8 minutes. The citizens of Damascus cheered their rocket marksman. Suddenly, a large section of the capital's population were on their feet and running towards the falling parachute. They have reason to dislike the Israelis. They're Palestinian refugees. The army joined in the hunt, though this soldier was 5 miles from where the pilot landed.
The pilot, with the aircraft, enters a mountain nearby, and I was very quickly, very quickly, I was on the little trees, some trees area. The parachute captured in the trees, and I saw all the people nearby coming to catch me. The civilian wanted to kill me, and it was very good that some soldiers there prevented.
Syrian soldiers.
Syrian soldiers, yeah. You can see it in the movie.
And a helicopter was used in case the parachute got stuck in the trees. And all the time, the pilot was dropping, watched by a whole city. He landed in what's called the Garden of Damascus, another area where the Israeli military are hated. For the people running to find the pilot are Syrian refugees, driven out of the Golan Heights in 1967. They'd been told he was a Syrian pilot. That probably saved his life, said a Syrian militia man. The army got the pilot into a truck, but the crowd was wild. The soldiers showed the frenzied crowd they meant business, firing over their heads. So the Israeli pilot was saved by his enemies, saved for a prisoner of war camp.
And then they took me to a prisoner of war jail, and they started to investigate me. I'll tell you like this, because I will not go into the detail. But when I ejected, I broke my left end. And I didn't know that my end was broken, in severe broken, because your mind, because of the tortures, is in another place. And I didn't know that. Only after 4 days in the first break in the investigations, I felt that my hand is not moving, and I recognized that something is not good here. But they didn't treat my hand. It by itself recover, but of course I couldn't move my hand properly. Only after 8 months, when we came to Israel, they took me to the hospital and did the best they can do, now almost perfect. I can tell you some points about the jail. First of all, I have to say that my daughter was born 3 weeks after I was shot down. Yeah. I was told that she was born only after 4 months, because the first 4 months I was isolated in a very small room. And after 4 months, yes, after 4 months, they gather all the pilots. And after another month, the Red Cross came, and they told me that I have a daughter. I knew that something should happen, but only then I knew that it would daughter. About the period that I was isolated, you know, I'm optimistic. Optimistic, yeah. And I felt very strong. I knew that because I was captured during the war, in the end of the war, there will be a prisoner exchange. So I knew that I will be back home. Once it will finish, and now that I am perfect in my body, the end is not so good, but you know, you can manage with the problem. So all the time I knew, and I was optimistic. I never broke and I didn't felt any bad situation. I was thinking between the investigation, because it took us all the time to investigate us, and between, I thought about the house, how I'll build this, and how I'll build this, and what I'll do then, and so on. All the time thinking. And during the first 2 months, I was totally isolated. Because in the next room, from both sides, no one was in the... All other pilots were in another place. Completely isolated. After 2 months, approximately, they put someone in the nearby room, and you know, it's like a monkey. I think about it, the way you learn to do something. I wanted to connect with him, to discuss with him, but I couldn't speak, of course. So it's naturally invented the way of speaking by knocking on the wall. And now you have to you have the situation that he will understand you. So in the beginning, I knocked the number of my squadron, 119. And I didn't understand what he told me. So to make it short, we start to knock on the door, on the wall, and Aleph, the first letter in Hebrew, was one knock. Yud is a tens letters in the Hebrew, it's 10 knocks, and Taf is the last letters, 22, so we knock 22. And then you have the time, no problem. So I knocked and knocked and knocked and so on, so we can discuss. I understood who is the man, and a lot of conversation about his family. I don't believe it, but this is what happened. So I understood what he was captured after I was, and I understood the situation in border is that we overcome the Syrian, and we are in Syria now, so it makes me more happy to understand that this is the situation. After 4 months, as I told you, they put us together, and we started to, you know, as you can see in World War II camps, we are not allowed to go out, but we could speak with each other, and we started. I learned there the bridge. One of the prisoners knew bridge, and he told us. One of them knew very good Arabic, and he told taught us to speak Arabic. And someone was responsible for the food. You start to live in a community. During this time, this period, we knew about our holidays. The Passover, the Yom HaAtzmaut, the Independence Day, and the Memorial Day, and we celebrate it. The Passover, everyone wrote some sentences from the Haggadah, which is a book that we read from in Passover. And in Yom HaAtzmaut, from some material, we draw the flag, and so on. It was very... and we played the Chachmat. You know, in community, there is groups. And I got the medal for the chess plays. I think that this was the period. When I came to Israel, back,
after how long?
8 months. 8 months. We came to Israel, and very quickly they took me to a hospital. They fixed my hand. And after I felt perfect, the hand was almost perfect, but it was good. you know, from the internal of me, I decided to come back to the squadron, to start fly again. And I flew again. I stopped flying only in 1998, after almost 30 years of flying. And I have to say that from time to time I felt this during, especially in a mission combat, that something was moving in the stomach, but you know, you have to control yourself. I have to tell you something about the food of the Cochin and how it connect to. Before the war, we went to be in a special place. From time to time in a fighter airplane, you have to be in alert, in a special alert, very short alert. And you live with three and other pilots in a small room. You get all the food and you cook it by yourself. And I have the touch of cooking from my house. I was looking at my mother and so on, and I took spices from her, and I took all the things that they brought us, and I was the chef. And it was going like this. They are coming, running to eat the food, sweat all over them, because it's very spicy, but they didn't allow me to stop it because they like very much the spicy food, yeah. Food was very bad in Syria, and all the time I thought, what I'm going to eat when I be back. And you start to think about the steaks, and, but finally, it was my mother's food. Yeah, the pastel, the chamandi, and the bakharchi. This was in my mind. You know, I like the cochini food very much, and even now I'm from time to time make the bakharchi, what we call, and some soup. The style of my mother soup, I like it very much. From time to time I'm doing it. It's only from time to time because my wife, she's cooking very good. So I took this situation as a soldier. You know, during the war, you can be killed, you can injured, you can come back with the shock of the war, and you can be in a prison. And I all the time I thought about this situation as I was in the war. It was very difficult war, and this was my part. This is what I had to pay because of the war. And you don't get any medal for it. You know that this flight to Damascus was through Lebanon, and we flew all the way, as I told you, very low level. So the radars will not find us. And above Lebanon, it's a mountain of Lebanon, it was cloudy, and we couldn't fly low level. So we separate, and then after the cloud was finished, because it's only the mountain, we found each other, and for this, this flight was record as a very brave flight. Mm-hmm. It was a very special flight, but we didn't get any medal. Mm-hmm. Only the leader, the leader got the medal for because it was decision to go, even though it was very hard. And we did it because the situation, we knew that the situation in Israel was very bad. That's why we did it. After the bombs were dropped. Yeah, after the bomb. I even at the time, a short time, to see that they hit the target, and then on the way down, I felt the anti-aircraft artillery hitting me. Mm-hmm. It was not missile, it was anti-aircraft artillery that shot us down. My wife is our second marriage, and Oh, I have three children, and she has three children, and all together we have now 12 grandchildren. And another girl is on the way. During November, we'll have another grandchild. And yes, they are mixed together, and they know our culture, because, you know, as I speak to you, they know the story, and they know the moshav, and know my family. We are coming together in all the holidays. Mm-hmm. My birthday is exactly in Sukkot. Mm-hmm. And you know this holiday. And in this holiday, we are coming all together to a big sukkah in my sister house. And we are sitting there all together, and during the year, we have some meetings that we are doing. So they are all mixed, and they all know about our food, about our history, and my sister in Nevatim, my sister in, no, we are going to see my sister in Tzur Igal. We are going to my sister in Tzur Igal. It's near Kfar Saba. It's near Kfar Saba. Sometime we are going even to my sister in Nevatim, but Sukkot, we are going to my sister in Kfar Saba, near Kfar Saba. I'm sure that the Kochins in Israel will do great and they will succeed. And I'm sure of that because of one point, looking on the villages and the towns where you can find Kochin. You know, in Israel you can see some Morocco, for example, that they think that everyone is hates them and don't give them what they deserve and so on. I don't feel it in the Kochin people. All the Kochin people are working. They are very good in the community, in the society. I didn't feel any
discrimination.
I didn't feel any discrimination during my high school. Of course, not in the Air Force, because, you know, it's a situation that if you are good, you are in the group. If you are looking all the time, oh, this one is not good for me, and this one hate me, and so on. I was looking forward, and it's a nature it's a nature of many of the coaching people in Israel. That's why I'm sure that will succeed, and you can find many coaching people in very good situation. You told me about the Bezalel Eliyahu that was invented the greenhouse. I didn't, I have to admit that I didn't.
There's only one example.
Yeah, so you can find many people in Israel. And you know, something is funny that we are proud that we are coachings, very proud. You know that in Israel, sorry for you, Daniel, but we are, when someone asks me, ah, you are from India? We say, all the coaches say, no, we are coaches. Mm-hmm. We are coaching, yeah. And then we explain that coaching is in the south part of India. But first of all, you are coaches. And even you are proud, you can find many people married who is not.
Most?
I don't know if it's a most, it yes. might be. But even though the children are my children, they are coaching. They know that they are coaches. They're proud, but they don't get married in the community because they are getting inside and involved. And my children like it very much. My mother now, she's not cooking and she's some dementia and so on. But when she was in full capability, they liked very much her food. They are coming to her, eating her food, and she loved very much to do it. We have some pictures of some grandchildren of her, and she's eating feeding them. Like
igli and sambar and all those things.
Igli, it's less because I think that igli is more... igli, yeah, it's... Yeah, yeah, yeah. Especially it's rice and erchikutan.
Appams.
Appams, yeah, and... chicken. You know, I was in Kerala in 1997 for the first time, and I saw beef, and I think that the Jewish people ate in those days. Now they are eating it. I'm sure of that. Now they are eating the Jewish. I think that in South Park they are not so fanatic, or even the Hindus.
Even the Hindus eat beef in Kerala.
Oh, you see, I didn't feel any strange of it. They eat the beef, yeah. Polichis, yeah. The chicken cooking is polichi.
Fried chicken.
My mother is frying the chicken, and then put it in a special and delicious sauce. Yeah, this is a polichi. I think that will maintain the tradition. I'm sure of that because look in, like an example from Nevatim. They have the synagogue, they are going, and it's not only the old people that are going there to the synagogue. You can see even young people and even children going to the synagogue. And that's why I'm sure that it will be kept. And it's not only in the villages, and it's even in town. We have here in Rishon, I think at least two synagogues and Jewish and Cochins coming to pray, and it's a synagogue of Cochins, and you can pray there. They keep, that's why I think it will be kept. You know, it might be that in two or three generations, it will not be the same. It might be that in two or three generations, it will mix with many ways, with the Moroccan or Ashkenazim, and it will be one kind of prey. Might be, I don't know. But as far as I can see, they will keep the special religious of the Cochins. The meeting of my wife is a special story, and we fall in love, the pastor, fall in love, and it caught us so strongly that it was a wonderful story for both of us. And you know, after your first chapter, some people want to live together, and that's all. We went through all the ceremonies, and we got married in a religious ceremony and so on. I think that it's one of the most important and things that happened to me, because I find myself now in complete
happiness,
and I don't know how to explain it in English, because it's something that is that inside. But
you found your place in life.
I found my place and found my wife, and you know, it was a very long story before we got married, from the moment we met each other and we got married. And all this period of time, people didn't believe that it will be the same as it today. And I thank God for it. My wife, from time to time, that there are some special events in my life that I will remember all the time. One of them is the day that I was told that I'm not flying anymore in the Air Force. And it was a very difficult day for me, very difficult set, because after many years that you are flying in combat situation and so on. And the other moment was the wedding. You know, it was something like heaven for me. I retired from the army as a colonel in 1997, and I was a deputy director general in the Israel Airport Authority for five years. And then I started to manage a big project in which I'm still working, which is replace and change all the systems in our missile range test, where we send our launch our HETs, for example. You know, you have radars, you had special communication, telemetry, computers and so on, and from time to time you have to replace all the systems, and that's what I did for many years. This is mainly the... And you know, I'm still served in reserve of the Air Force, because during a missile launch of HETS, for example, if the missile is going in his path that was planned for him, it's okay. But once in malfunction, for example, if we'll go to another place, then it might be very dangerous and you have to destroy him. And I got the capability. I'm the safety officer in this test to destroy the missile in case there is some malfunction. So some people ask me how you can be in reserve in your age, but once you feel it's very important, you have the capability, they enjoy it, I enjoy it, I'm doing it, and they need me, yeah. I think that the Jewish community from Cochin, it might be that all the people there, I feel it's, they are very strong inside, but they are very kind and
delicate.
They are very delicate. You will not see them shouting and aggressive and so on. But they will go to the target in their own way. I see many people. I can feel it. You know, it's another way of behave. They will get what they want. They are very determined. They are very determined. They are not, they will not break if something is difficult from them. They will go slowly and slowly and do it. Another thing that I can see about the on the people is that they know to take things in proportional. My mother told me many times, that I have to treat people in honor. Even you are angry with them, you have to be kind to people. She told me not to give up on things, and this is common to many people in our community. My wife, Esti, and we are married from 2005. It's almost 11 years, and I love her very much. I told you before, and this is my brother, Avraham. He's younger. 2 months, 2 years for me. He was born in kibbutz Bet Hashita, and he was, during the Yom Kippur, he was a paratrooper in the Sinai. And now is
CPA controller.
Controller? I have to tell you something about the situation of me and my brother fighting during the Yom Kippur War. You know, as young man, young soldier, you are going to fight. You don't think. And I have to admit that it didn't happen that all the time I thought, where is my brother now? Where is my brother? What is doing? I didn't think about it all the times. But I didn't think even about my parents, how they feel about the situation that they have now two sons in the army during a very difficult war. It came to me when I was a father of two soldiers. I have three children, one girl, 43 years old, and twins, they are 39. She knows even this. 39, and they were soldiers together. And during their service, one of them was infantry in special forces of in Lebanon, and the other one was in submarine. And you know, I felt very difficult, very difficult in this. I would not say scared, but it was difficult. From time to time, I heard the sirens of helicopters going to Lebanon in case of problems. I came to my squadron, I flew in those days. My squadron, from time to attack in Lebanon, in situations that I know that my son might be there. Only then I understood what was it, how difficult was the situation to my parents with two sons in the war. Mm-hmm. And I have to admire my parents for it. Short story about my parents. I have to tell, I told you they're very determined and so on. They wanted very much that we learn, and they did everything. Even though they don't have high education, they made a lot of effort. So we can be in high school and so on, and they can be proud of us. I will tell you something about my children, what I think about them in Israel. It's not only the children, it's even the grandchildren and so on. I'm not afraid of wars and the problems because of our neighbors. We have a very strong army, and you can see it from the beginning of this country that we succeeded even if in Yom Kippur War, that it was started in a very bad situation in the beginning. Even this war, we won. I don't think that the problem is our neighbors. It's mainly the internal conflicts in Israel that make people from time to time feel it's enough for me and so on. And what I can say, it's only our country. You cannot, if you go to another place, it's only escape from the land that is our land. Is the only place that you can be safe, because you know, once you are in another country, you can have problem in another country. Look what happened to the people in France. Look what happened to the people in Russia. The reason that came here, it's problem in Russia. In France, you can see it. In many places, people have problems. You have to fight the problem and not to escape from the problem. I hope that in Israel the internal situation will be better. That's what I can...